Okay, so last week we divided into groups, and I assigned different groups different specific quotes from this front and back sheet, or at least, I think you started at different numbers, and we tried to cover all of them. So all of the quotes here were from, most of them were from ministers, Christian ministers, in the 19th century about the idea, the institution of slavery. And to me, it was very telling, and it sounded like it was telling for you as well. Some of the things that I underlined that kind of jumped out to me from each quote, like in number one, the Baptist preacher and denominational leader, Richard Furman, who Furman University is named after, he said, the right of holding slaves is clearly established in the Holy Scriptures. So we'll talk about that a little more. We've read some of those specific scriptures over the past few weeks. Number two, the Baptist in number two said that it was the abolitionists in the North whose fault it was that Baptists had to split, that Baptists in the South had to break away. The Baptists in the South claimed that all of the great wealth generated by the God-ordained institution of slavery could advance the cause of missions, which is an interesting slant to take. That was another reminder to me that if somebody has this opinion or preference or something that they like, and we all do this about anything, big and small, our brains are remarkably creative and will come up with really impressive and or wild arguments to support this thing that we want or that we like or that we prefer. And so it's very interesting that one of the arguments was, yeah, but slavery can help raise money for missions, so you wouldn't want to stop that, would you? Don't you like missions? And it kind of puts the other person in the odd position of going, well, yes, but. Number three was interesting that local Baptist Association, Alabama, said that since God allowed slavery to happen, therefore, it must be God-ordained, which is also an interesting argument. Their argument basically is, since it exists, God must therefore be totally cool with it. Which, I'm not very comfortable with that argument, because I have a really good friend whose father died when a drunk driver hit his car. And that did happen. That was a thing. Does that mean that that was God ordained? A few months ago, we heard from the local mom who lost her sweet daughter, Kalina Minch, to childhood cancer. That did happen, but just because something happened, does that mean it's God ordained for her sweet daughter to die of cancer? So that argument definitely kind of rubs me the wrong way to support slavery. Very interesting, number six, the Virginian who called the Civil War a war between Christians and infidels. So not just a war between white Christians who agree to disagree, but it was a war between Christians, we could say, in his mind, real Christians, and infidels or non-Christians. Number seven, it was interesting how the Confederate Vice President said that the South was left with no recourse other than to turn to war. It's like, we didn't want to have to do it, but we didn't have a choice in order to preserve God's wills for the races. So again, you can see they are just totally convinced that it is God's will for black people to remain enslaved. Then on the back, the first thing that jumped out to me on number eight is that this speech was delivered by the pastor of a church that I have attended in the past. First Baptist Church, Macon, Georgia. Me and Sarah, and at that point, baby Sean, we went to First Baptist Macon a number of times. We didn't stay there for years, but we knew the staff. Anyways, just hearing, well, I've been there. I've been in that sanctuary where this speech was given. And the pastor at the time said, both Christianity and slavery are from heaven, and both are blessings to humanity. And then he said, the condition of the slaves affords them all these privileges, which would prove substantial blessings to them. Isn't that a stretch? It's for their own good, he's saying. And then he says, and too, because their maker, God, has declared, has decreed their bondage. Like this, again, this is a God thing. And has given them as a race capacities and aspirations, suited alone to this condition of life. So again, it's that argument, like, this is what God intended for society to look like, for those who are black skinned to be enslaved. And their belief is so strong, it was striking to read. At the end of number 9, Alabama Baptist minister I.T. Tickner said it was caused by, that the Civil War was caused by the mad attempts of fanaticism to deprive us of our rights, to overthrow our institutions, meaning slavery, which implies, you know, I would think, and this is my opinion, that slavery is wrong, and if you work to stop it, I would say then you are doing God's will. Again, my opinion, if you're trying to stop slave trafficking, I'm going to call that you're doing God's will. And I guess that means that sometimes when you're working really hard to do the right thing, others might call your work mad attempts at fanaticism. Then in number 10, the SBC, Southern Baptist Convention, stated in the 1860s, we contend that slavery is a scriptural institution. So I wanted to hang on that for a little bit. We've read Bible verses over the past few weeks that would support that argument. There are many other Bible verses. Those were just a few of the ones I picked out. And I don't like being in the position of, like, verifying the arguments of slaveholders, but it is in the Bible. And I wanted to hear what you all thought about that, because their argument, and some of their different arguments, some were, as you could hear, a lot more of a stretch than others, but the ones who said it's in the Bible, they weren't wrong. It's in the Bible. And I'll talk about it in a minute. Not only is it just mentioned in the Bible, but it's kind of regulated. Like, here's how you should treat your slaves. So someone last week said, I'm giving the slaveholders too much credit. And I hate that. I don't want to do that. Nevertheless, it is in the Bible. You know what I mean? And that's hard. That's hard for me, and I hope it's been hard for you. And I'll mention in a minute, they, slaveholders had a lot of Bible verses, and they could say, hey, it's in the Bible. It's in black and white. What, do you not? You don't want to follow the Bible? Is that it? That's what I'm hearing, abolitionists. You don't want to follow the Bible. It's in there. And as a Christian who follows the Bible, I have to recognize that that is an argument that deserves attention, you might say. But did you have any thoughts about that idea, or other thoughts about all the quotes on the sheet? What did you make of all those quotes and those arguments?
It's easy for us to sit here in the 21st century and look back at all this way back yonder in history and poo-poo everything that was said. But if we had been raised in that society,
yeah,
and the Bible talks about slavery from beginning to end, so at least it was tolerated by all who lived in that era, just as it was tolerated by those who lived in history in the past.
Yeah, and I think that point bears remembering that it can be easy and tempting for us to judge and to say, oh, well, look at those people in the past. They were so bad. We figured it out. And to kind of use them as like a scarecrow kind of target, like a scapegoat. Like, oh, they were all bad. We figured it out to kind of get us off the hook. Because like Bill said, I mean, I grew up in Louisiana when I was a kid. And if I had been born, 150 years earlier and then went to seminary, I probably would have heard all those things, and that was the water that I would have swam in, you know what I mean? So I don't know how I would have ended up, but I certainly would have been a product of Louisiana in, the 1820s or something. And so we shouldn't pretend that we are so much better than people in the past who certainly make terrible, terrible mistakes. We're human too. And so we really need to watch ourselves and check ourselves. Thank goodness the culture and the mindset has improved a little bit since then. Back then, if I were to have grown up then, I would have been a product of that culture as well. Yeah,
I think our country is not the only country experiencing slavery.
Sure.
Other nations and powers that be way before us had slavery. But self-interest creates a lot of wrongs, and it doesn't make things right. And I think in slavery, there's a lot of self-interest. And I read some of these comments from people with self-interest. And I can take that approach and make anything in the scripture look okay. So I think you have to, I agree, I don't think we sit in the judgment seat. That's not our role. But I think we can look back in history and assess that and say, I don't believe that's what God intended. And so I think self-interest and our own well-being creates a lot of things. And I think we can see that in slavery.
Yeah.
And other things.
Yeah, in everything, really. And I wonder if that's kind of the common denominator of sin, really, is us indulging in our self-interest and only doing kind of what we want and what we feel like, instead of focusing on, loving our neighbor as ourself and loving the Lord with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Maybe that's kind of the common denominator of all sin. Yeah. Well, let's go back to the three questions that we were pondering last week, and everyone was kind of divided up into different groups and thought about these questions just for a few of the quotes. But now that you've had a chance to look over all the quotes and hopefully kind of read or think about all the quotes, what would you say to the first question? What do you think of their arguments that you heard in here? Convincing, not convincing? Were some stronger than others?
Take them about as much as I take all Paul's other wives and concubines.
Are the four corners of the earth spoken of in Revelation? And we don't have the four corners of the earth.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And one thing, people have a way, as time passes, they will rearrange things to fit whatever they will fit. Mm-hmm. I've seen this question time and time again that slavery was 400 years. That's true. For the North Africa, white men have put in prison for black people for 400 years. Mm-hmm. In North Africa, that was facts all through Bible. Very rare to hear that. Very rare to hear that the white man was enslaved for 400 years. The black man in this country was enslaved for 87 years. 1776, 1861.
I think the first documented slave might have been 1619.
Yes, in the colonies.
If you go back before that, you've got to take that blame.
It goes back to other countries too, other countries around the world.
Germany, Mexico, and Russia. We've all were stolen, this project turned in before we were.
So it sounds like it's a human problem.
Yes.
And like I said, we do have a way of changing things and changing things to get on from these. Like I said, that one part about the time, and I mentioned about the other countries. There were other countries that said, the Industrial Revolution made it more financially advantageous to pay a worker two pennies an hour and don't worry about it. It is to try to take care of the 24 hours a day if you have to do the crops. It was a whole lot cheaper to just pay them aside. And so that's why the North, eventually got totally away from slavery, even though Lincoln only freed the slaves in the South. The North's not the slave. And Lincoln was not the president of the South, Jefferson Davis was, so Lincoln didn't really have that right when he did it. So the small things, like I said, we change history to fit what we think would be a better story.
That's true. We certainly do that.
Stuart, I think some of the things that happened here in these comments that happened in slavery hasn't been cured yet. Some of that mindset exists today, and power has a lot to do with that. Having power over a situation or other people. I wish I could ask these people, how do you reconcile the Old Testament and New Testament? Did you not read the New Testament? I guess you just forgot about it. But how do you reconcile what Christ said in the New Testament, the new era of grace? Okay? I'd like to have a dialogue as to how did you see that it still exists. But I think power has a lot to do with holding people captive. That still happens today, even in our country. People who have power, so I think that lived in a part of that as well.
Yeah, it's like that saying, power corrupts. And anytime someone has some power, it's very tempting to do whatever you need to do to keep it and to maintain it. And that's a temptation that everyone would feel. And I think you're right that whites in the American South before the Civil War would have, they obviously held all the power, and any human feels the temptation to keep the power that they have. Yeah. Let's see. So how does, we talked about that a little bit last week, how do their arguments compare with what the Bible says and what you think? And the last question, how would you respond to them? So it is an interesting kind of thought experiment. What if they were hanging around here now, or we could go back in time? How would you respond to them and their arguments?
Yeah. I wouldn't respond like this lady was giving a lecture and said, if this is okay, how many of you would like to be black? She didn't get any takers, she said it again. If that's a good thing, let's change.
I assume they would say, well, we wouldn't want to be black for all the bad reasons that they listed. And they might say, God ordained that we would be white or something, I don't know. Well, what if, not just if you responded to them, but what if someone today had stumbled onto this research and had done some academic reading and read what many of the preachers in the American South before the Civil War had said and what they felt and what they encouraged their church people to say, and someone came up to you and said, how could Christians say those things? What would you say to that person? Because that could happen. I mean, someone could come up to you, because there's a lot of people in the world today who are very antagonistic towards Christianity or towards organized religion. And so they might kind of come up with some ready-made argument points, and they'd say, well, what about this? How could people claim to be Christians say those things? And you don't have to respond out loud now, but I think it bears giving some time to think about. And I welcome suggestions, because that would be a touchy conversation.
Well, Bill said that's a lot of environment and upbringing.
Mm-hmm.
That's hard to get over that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is hard. It is hard to get over that.
Particularly for people that don't get into thinking.
Yeah. And like someone said last week, education really lacked. And education goes a long way in helping someone kind of realize the shortcomings of the water they've been swimming in.
If you go back 100 to 200 years ago, there was a significant percentage of the population could not read or write.
Mm-hmm.
So you had some person in a position that really exerted their authority, so-called authority, or ideas, and people wasn't able to read and find out about that, just accept it. Same way in the world today.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta think. And so I think that may have played in. I do think the environment, what we refer to, plays a lot into how we act and what we do.
Mm-hmm.
We can always look back at history and say, maybe we should have done this rather than that. So it is a learning tool to go back and look. Mm-hmm. But I think a lot of people didn't question it, just accepted it.
Yeah. And so when they were presented with a different option, the idea of abolition, destroying the institution of slavery, then a lot of people resisted that as an option. And as I was looking into some of these historical quotes, it was really interesting to see how Christian leaders in the 19th century weren't totally sure if the Bible actually supported the abolition movement at all to free black slaves in the United States. Because, like we have read, it's in the Bible. And that's an argument that you might hear about a lot of different issues. Hey, it's in the Bible. The Bible says so. And so in the 19th century, a lot of Christians were unsure, even if they were uncomfortable with slavery, they weren't even sure if the Bible supported getting rid of slavery or not. And it was Christians on the pro-slavery side would accuse Christians who supported abolition of ignoring those clear, specific verses that we have read and others, of ignoring those obvious verses in favor of vague generalities about love and justice. So the pro-slavery Christians would say that abolitionists ignored the clear, plain meaning of the Bible and thereby threatened the whole authority of the Bible. They would have said, oh, you're just going to ignore those Bible verses, huh? Well, brother, that's a slippery slope. What's next? You're going to ignore other Bible verses you don't like? And other ones? Why don't we just throw the whole Bible out if you're going to start ignoring some of the Bible verses because slavery's in there? And that would have been part of their argument. In fact, it was. The pro-slavery Christians would have said, what, are you going to start throwing out Bible verses and not following the Bible? That's a dangerous precedent to start, my friend. That is a slippery slope. And then as time went on, they would grow more insistent on pointing to those very clear Bible verses and grew stronger in their criticism of the abolitionists' blatant disregard for what they considered biblical truths. So here's some examples I'll toss out to you. And I thought about making another quote handout, but last week's quote handout was heavy. In more ways than one. So I thought I'd just read these to you. So this is from 1860. A Presbyterian preacher, Henry Van Dyke, said, The tree of abolition is evil and only evil, root and branch, flower, leaf, and fruit. It springs from and is nourished by an utter rejection of the scriptures. When an abolitionist tells me that slaveholding is a sin, in the simplicity of my faith in the Holy Scriptures, I point him to this sacred record and tell him, in all candor, as my text does, that his teaching blasphemes the name of God and his doctrine. Strong words. Another example, Moses Stewart of Andover Seminary in Massachusetts published a tract in which he pointed to many of the specific Bible verses that we have read, but also many others, to argue that while slaves should be treated fairly by their owners, he said abolitionists don't have scripture on their side at all and must abandon the fiery course which they are pursuing. What's that fiery course they are pursuing? Any guesses?
Hell.
Hell. He was implying that because abolitionists didn't have scripture on their side, as he said, then they were going against the Bible, thereby going against God's will. That's called a sin in his mind. And when you do that and you're not repentant of it, well, it only sends you one way, a fiery course, he called it. Here's another example from Methodist minister J.W. Ticker. He told a Confederate audience in 1862, "Your cause is the cause of God, the cause of Christ, the cause of humanity. So this is a conflict between truth and error, between the Bible and Northern infidelity, of pure Christianity and Northern fanaticism." So again, you hear some of those same words that we heard in the quotes from last week, fanaticism, infidelity, and how they felt they were truly doing God's will, which is a dangerous position to be in when you are so convinced that everything you happen to want, God also wants, and you will never listen to any other ideas. It's a dangerous position to be in. So we need to remember to be humble, because we are all human. And if we had lived back then, we might have thought differently. So as you can hear in those quotes, Christians advocating for slavery didn't just think that their abolitionist Christian brothers disagreed with them on biblical interpretation. Pro-slavery Christians accused abolitionists of abandoning the Bible completely. So they urged their church members back to that plain meaning. Just follow the plain meaning of the Bible and don't bother with complicated, nuanced ideas that will cloud your mind. Don't. Like Wayne said earlier about the thinking, like don't think too hard about it. No. Don't think too hard about it. Just follow clear verses in the Bible. So they would cite many of those Bible verses to support their argument, and they would point out, as we've said, slavery was practiced by people of Israel, was regulated by God, and they would point out, and we haven't mentioned this yet, that Jesus never said anything specifically against slaveholding, which is kind of true. I mean, he never spoke words that were specifically against the institution of slaveholding. So as far as an argument goes, okay. And also they would point out that the Apostle Paul instructed an escaped slave named Onesimus to return to his master. And that's what the letter of Philemon was about, the book of Philemon. Also probably why the book of Philemon doesn't get read a lot in churches today, because Paul was encouraging Onesimus to go back to his master. So that was their argument. And I mean, again, I'm saying, like, to other Christians, that argument is going to sound like it holds water, because the argument of it is in the Bible, period, in black and white. I mean, we have to acknowledge that in that sense, they weren't wrong. I mean, they were kind of wrong with a capital W, we can say. But as far as it is in the Bible. So what were the arguments that the abolitionists were trying to convey? Well, they had a little harder time of it. They had to appeal to the broad message of the Bible, the broad sweep of Scripture and its meanings. So, you know, more bigger generalities of love and justice and loving your neighbor in kind of a bigger, broader sense. Apparently, there was one public debate in 1845 between Nathaniel Rice, who was pro-slavery, and Jonathan Blanchard, who was anti-slavery. And the debate lasted 4 days, 8 hours a day. Rice, pro-slavery, would tie the other guy up in knots over how to interpret those pro-slavery Bible verses. And the anti-slavery guy, Blanchard, he kept going back to those big principles of, you know, equality, like that verse in Galatians 3 that we read, loving your neighbor, like Jesus said. And he would refer to the whole message of the Bible. So he didn't have as clear, obvious verses to counteract all the many clear and obvious verses that the pro-slavery guy did. And at the time, like we said, kind of a lack of education, not thinking about it too much, many Bible-believing Christians, they just weren't buying the abolitionists' argument. Because the abolitionists were saying, no, we need to listen to and follow the spirit of the law, not the letter of the law. There was one Congregationalist minister, Leonard Bacon, who said, the biblical evidence supporting slavery cannot be got rid of without resorting to methods of interpretation that will get rid of everything. So again, it's that slippery slope argument that they used. So we're throwing out Bible verses we don't like, are we? Well, you better watch yourself, brother, because once you start down that path, you might as well throw out the whole thing. Some abolitionists did argue that they recognize the Bible doesn't condemn slavery per se specifically. It does condemn the kind of slavery treatment that was practiced in the American South, which was a good argument, but again, it's nuanced. Most people have trouble with nuanced arguments, so they needed people to understand what slavery was like in the Greco-Roman world. They needed people to have kind of thought about the whole message of the Bible, and that broader nuanced argument just didn't carry as much weight as the common sense, literal approach to, hey, it's in the Bible. What more do I need to say? Regina.
Did the Exodus story come up at all in these arguments in the Old Testament of the whole, because I have heard in history that, like, specifically slave Bibles, or, you know, they would take those verses out, any type of liberation, because they didn't want them to have that as, well, God freed these people, why wouldn't God free us? So if that was going through their minds, was that an argument at all in the that you saw in this?
Yeah.
Like, you talk about the arguments of the abolitionists to the New Testament verses, but did they use the Old Testament of that, or the year of Jubilee and release all of, you know, your debts and your properties and people and all of that? Was that in these arguments at all?
That's a very good question. In my cursory research, it did not come up that was used by white people. Like you pointed out, the Exodus story was very important to black and enslaved people because it gave them hope. And the book that I kind of read about is called The Civil War as a Theological Crisis. And that author, Mark Knoll, kind of summarized a lot of the main argument points of both the pro-slavery and the anti-slavery Christians. So perhaps in that book, he might go into more detail, but I did not have time to read that whole book and go into. Wayne.
Just a thought or question. How did, and I'll use this phrase is thrown out all the time now, racism, that in the slavery situation, the Caucasian race is superior.
That's what they would have said,
And that's not only black people, it's Native Americans and everything's been treated that way. Mm-hmm. And that's in our world today, right now. People still feel that way, which is ridiculous. But was that a major factor, you think, in the mindset of some of the religious community, that we are superior to anybody else down here?
Yes, I think they would have looked at how society was structured and said, well, look, all the white people are in charge, and then you can see these other races have less and less power. So that's the way it is. God must be okay with that. So that's what God wants. So, hey, everybody, God wants this. Let us work to support this. And that they definitely would have said that. Yeah, Ms. Wilma. Yes.
Maybe it's not the same, because slavery in the 1800s, these people were bought and sold. But in the biblical times, some people had nothing, so they willingly went and were servants to these kings, because so they could have things.
Yeah.
So there may be some difference in how we look at it.
Yes.
We call slavery.
Yes. That is a really, really important point. And in a lot of the verses translated into English, some Bible translations might use the English word slave. Other English translations of that same verse might use the word servant, because the setup in both the Old and the New Testament was not the kind of setup that was in the American South. It wasn't like a true ownership of a lesser human being forever kind of thing. It would have been, like you said, like an indentured servitude, where someone could gain a place to live and gain employment and wouldn't have had rights. But it seems that the cruelty wasn't there under the slave or the servant system in the Bible. And so that's what the abolitionist Christians were trying to get across. They'd say, well, yeah, there's verses in the Bible about slavery and servanthood, but that looked like this. Here in our country, it's looking like this, and it's wrong to treat people that way. And that's why accepting their argument, which is true, it takes a level of nuanced understanding of, society in the Greco-Roman world compared with now, and kind of translations and different systems. And it was just a little too much for people to accept when the other side was saying, it's in the Bible, period, it's black and white. What are you gonna do? Prove me wrong. That in comparison, those arguments, one just landed a lot stronger, unfortunately. But yeah, you're exactly right, All right, well, let's pause it now. It's 1 minute till 7. Be thinking about this. And let it challenge you, and I do want to go back to what Bill said, let it challenge you to really be humble and to not think that you or any of us today are better humans, who were created as better humans than people 200 years ago, because we are all humans, and I would hate to think what we might have thought had we grown up in that society as well. So Brian has a handout for you tonight. It's got some excerpts from two books, mainly an excerpt from the book Huckleberry Finn, which is a really convicting excerpt and story with some questions. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And like I said last week, love your neighbor as yourself, for goodness sakes.